Public service announcement. Change your passwords.
True facts. Hi, everybody. I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
And this is the Concept Crucible Podcast.
And today we talk about secrets.
And confidences.
And privacy.
Yes. And how these are different and meaningfully different things and important things to know the difference between.
Yes, because actually before you started to kind of differentiate, I always, you know, conflated secrets and privacy.
Hmm. Yeah, it's one of, I don't know, it's one of those things I think a lot about when I'm sort of like compartmentalizing what I know and how I feel, and more importantly, how to behave with respect to that, mm-hmm. like the kinds of conversations I have with people, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. You know, whether or not they're like they're in confidence versus not, mm-hmm. And what that means. So mm-hmm. I spend a lot of time sort of trying to understand this stuff, mm-hmm. And I have a model. But first, icebreaker. Mm-hmm. Ryan, what is a secret that you keep or have kept?
I'm going to go with one that I have kept, and it's probably starting to be a little grating to our listeners for me to constantly talk about the engagement and stuff like that, but I mean, let's put a context to this. I really am terrible at, like, Christmas time with buying a gift and then just not giving it to a person right away, be like, I'm so excited to give this to you here, right? So like, if I buy it at the start of December, this is probably why I shop at the, you know, last minute, so I don't have to keep the secret for very long. So, but if you can imagine that Christmas is incredibly difficult, I made the decision to get a ring like October 1st, knowing full well that I was not going to be proposing until 2 months later, which you might think not necessarily a lot of time. But it is incredibly difficult to coordinate that and not tip off the significant other and leak the information to only certain people who need to know and contain that information. So, for example, I had to ask Sarah's mom for the, you know, the permission to marry her daughter, and I wanted to tell at least her eldest brother. But when the idea of Sarah and I getting married came up, he got red-faced and misty-eyed. And I'm like, I can't tell him. He's gonna blow it for me. I have 1 week to go, like, at the time that this happened. God. I have 1 week to go. He is going to ruin it for me.
Your secrets fucking suck, man.
I know my secrets suck. But, like, I have
three Huckles can keep a secret if all three of them are dead.
Pretty much. I mean, it's... I don't know, I live a fairly bland life, so... So, but that was a secret that I kept.
This is the best secret. Trust me. In the pre-show, it was like one time in seventh grade, I'm just like, please, man, no. Can't bring that to the podcast.
Yeah, I know. I know. I have secrets. I just don't really keep a lot of big compromising ones. There's a couple, I guess. But
yeah, but I mean, I also don't expect you to divulge a secret for the audience. Though if you'd like to, now would be the time.
The NSA and FBI do not have my permission to be listening in on this conversation.
Oh, all right. Well, by all means then, sir, now that you've said that.
And I'll make it as part of the description box.
You need to copy and paste it as part of your Facebook status.
Everybody must copy and paste it so that they know that they do not have our permission to use or view our content. Because the description said so. Jim?
Awesome.
What's a secret you have kept or are willing
to divulge for the entertainment of other human beings,
or maybe talk about in an interesting way at the periphery without actually divulging the secret?
No, I hate that.
Yeah,
that's,
I know.
That's the worst. Like, that's the worst conversations. Like and by worst in this sense, I mean most painful. The most painful conversations that you will ever have are the ones where you try not to say something. Unless you're a politician, in which case, I guess, go nuts.
Yeah.
But...
they do go nuts. I go nuts listening to them on the CBC.
But, no. So I have kept many, many secrets. I am certainly no stranger to them. I have kept secrets, adopted a policy of keeping those secrets, continued to keep secrets, mm-hmm. et cetera, et cetera. I continue to have them.
You are not a Kantian.
No.
Yeah.
Certainly not. All right, well, I mean, at least in the sense that I'm bad at following rules that I set for myself.
Yeah.
No, so secrets I have kept include, but are not limited to, talking about depression and panic attacks. Mm-hmm. I mean, for a long time. Like often we keep secrets because we're really ashamed of them. And I spent a whole bunch of time sort of living in my own head and being really weird about the ways in which I was struggling. Partly because I didn't know how to talk about them. Mm-hmm. But the only way I would learn how to talk about them is by trying to talk about them with people. Mm-hmm. And there's some elaborate talking around that happened during that time. And now I talk about it relatively freely, but I still hold it secret from some people. Mm-hmm. If you follow me on the internet, you're well aware that I am an anxiety bro and that kind of thing. But for example, at my office, where I have concerns about whether or not it would impact, the way that people work with me. There's a couple of people who are aware, but for the most part, and to be fair, like for the most part, it is none of their business. Mm-hmm. It is not simply a secret. Mm-hmm. And we're gonna get into that when we talk about the distinction between secrets and confidences and privacy. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's actually a pretty good example. Mm-hmm. Secrets are things you keep from people. Because we're ashamed, because we're afraid, because we're nervous, because we're concerned. Like, it doesn't all have to be negative feelings.
Yeah, I was thinking about this after we did the pre-show, and I was driving home, and I was like, I feel like hiding a secret from other people simply for shame or any kind of negative, I feel like it... There's a missing piece in there that's not quite, say, professional confidentiality and stuff like that, but like the actual side of like I just don't want people to know for strategy reasons.
Yeah.
Strategic reasons.
And that's you're right. That's the thing we hadn't talked about. But you know, keeping secrets to gain an advantage.
Yeah.
And to keeping secrets to leverage later. Mm-hmm. You're right. I was going to make an argument that those are confidences, but they're not. And mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right. Those are.
It depends on the context.
It depends a lot on the context.
Yeah. Well, but in that case, segue, confidence.
So confidences I would describe as things you keep for people instead mm-hmm. of from them.
Or maybe even another preposition might be about.
Yeah.
Because like somebody can divulge something. We talked about this as a distinction. You can know something about somebody, even if they don't necessarily know it, but you keep it in confidence because it's about or pertaining to somebody else.
I usually use for, partly because it juxtaposes well with the one before it.
Yeah.
And also just that the idea that when someone gives you a confidence, that is what they're doing. They're giving you a piece of information, whether they know it or not, mm-hmm. that you're going to hold on to. Because a lot of confidences we keep aren't like strictly confidences. Like there are obvious confidences where someone says, "Please don't tell anyone else," mm-hmm. Or "I'm telling you this in confidence," mm-hmm. and it's explicit. Mm-hmm. But I mean, like moments where people are really vulnerable are probably not things you want to Facebook about. Mm-hmm. Is that idea of like, just because something is not explicitly a confidence doesn't mean it isn't implicitly a confidence. Mm-hmm. And confidences are often told in situations of safety and areas like that. Mm-hmm. So, and they're precious. Confidences are exercises in trust. Mm-hmm. And we hold on to them for all kinds of good reasons. I mean, we're going to talk about... I mean, there are obviously reasons to violate our confidence, too, but... and the last one is privacy. Mm-hmm. And this one I didn't think of until much, much, much later. Because I spent a bunch of time thinking and writing about secrets and confidences during my undergrad. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, there are things that are not secret that are also not confidences. Mm-hmm. Huck, what's your credit card number?
Actually, I don't know my credit card number.
Don't announce your credit card number on air.
No, I mean, like, I know my debit card number, and I could probably recognize my credit card number, but yeah, I actually don't know it, so it's pretty secure.
It's okay, just hold it up to the camera. That, for listeners, that was not the sound of Huck holding his credit card up to the camera. But if you do want to go to the YouTube video and watch, we will take the views.
I was actually going to say, maybe we should, that would be the incentive to try to push people through the funnel towards YouTube.
Let's not.
All right.
But, yeah, your credit card number, your PIN, things like that, it's information about you. Mm-hmm. Or about things that you own and things that you have, your passwords, that is your business and only your business.
Yeah, for any number of reasons. I mean, health information, you know, that's kind of like vulnerable information. That's why, for example, just as like a kind of a practical application of this, as a security guard, if you want to come into the bar, I can demand to see certain kinds of information. I mean, you don't have to give it to me, but if you want to gain entry, I can demand to see certain kinds of verification. The general criteria is it's got to be government issued, it's got to have a photo on it, it's got to have an expiry date on it, it's got to have your birthday on it, you know, things like that. One card that fits most criteria in the province of Ontario and most other provinces is your health card. The way it's kind of legislated is, at my discretion, I can accept your health card as a valid form of ID if you provide it, but I am not allowed to ask it of you. And we have to be very careful about that. Like, when I suggest, like, oh, a health card will work, but I'm not suggesting that, you know, I have to see their health card, you know, if they don't have a driver's license or something. I can accept it. And I know some bars don't. And that is entirely because the health, your health number, at least in the province of Ontario, is tied to you, and it is tied to your private medical health records. Mm-hmm. And so, from a bar's point of view, that's not information that we need to know. But also, from a privacy point, that's not something that you should be divulging to other people, other than a licensed healthcare provider. So there's a practical example of just a subtle difference between, you know, identifications actually makes a huge difference.
Yeah. Well, and I think it also highlights the idea of, there are situations where you can be compelled to give up certain private information. Mm-hmm. Conditionally, mm-hmm. bouncers can't stop you on the street and ask you for your ID. Mm-hmm. That's police officers. Mm-hmm. But if you want to get into the bar, you have to verify your age. Health cards are funny like that, too, because you can't use health cards to buy cigarettes.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah. At least not when I used to sell cigarettes.
It might be for the same reason.
No, because it isn't just that you can't ask for them. As a store clerk, you can't accept them. Mm. Presumably because the Ontario Health Commission does not want you buying cigarettes.
That's probably true,
with their photo ID.
I mean, from a just a security point of view, the health card has the least amount of information that helps you to verify the person is who they say they are. I mean, really, it's a picture, the birthday. I don't even remember if there's a signature on it. The signature helps, because you can ask somebody to give you a signature comparison. I've done that before. Whereas the driver's license has your height, it has your address, and it has, well, the issue and expiry dates, especially because I work, or at least my clients are...
I feel like the address is the big one.
Well, the address is a big one because it allows me to ask... It allows me to ask for details that I now have information about. But like, you know, the graduated driver's license system, if I know they're of a certain age, then I know roughly when their licenses are valid for. And it allows me to work backwards and kind of verify whether or not they are who they say they are and stuff. So all sorts of complex mathematics going on when I'm checking your ID.
Oh, man. But yeah, secrets, confidences, and privacy. Mm-hmm. And privacy, I mean, is the big one. I think in life, I mean, we live in a world now, like, crossing, like, there's all kinds of concerns about privacy when crossing the U.S. border. Privacy in terms of your internet traffic, your social media traffic. What is private? What is not? What that is public in your life should be private, or has a right to be private. Mm-hmm. And there's
even innocuous data gathering that is not necessarily secret or private, but the fact that it is logged becomes a concern. Like, for example, if you have an Android attached to Google, it tracks your GPS locations, and you can actually, within the Google system, find it, and it'll map it out for you where your phone was logged in, which is not necessarily a secret thing, because that information can be gleaned through other means, you know, like...
But it is.
But it's
we have definitely in the last two decades expanded our ideas of private and privacy, and also I think in a lot of cases had to become more fluent in the language of privacy and the idea of privacy than we ever needed to be before. Hmm. You know, I think it chalks up partly into the fact that we are now realizing that the internet is a real place. Hmm. And that's weird for some people.
It's still weird to me. It's still weird for me to think of it like a space. Because I tend to be a very geospatial kind of person.
So. Well, the internet has geospatial locations.
I know, sort of.
Kind of.
Kind of, yeah.
It's a series of tubes.
Tubes. All over the place. Just tubes.
Anyway, there are, of course, reasons to violate confidences.
Yeah.
There are reasons to expose secrets.
Mm-hmm.
One of the ones we didn't talk about in the pre-show, but is worth talking about, is whistleblowing.
Yeah.
Whistleblowing, if you've taken ethics, whistleblowing is always like a huge conversation in ethics classes, and about like the ethics of whistleblowing, and because it is the kind of thing that almost always has severe legal consequences one way or another, but it's often where legality and ethics differ.
Mm-hmm.
Like whistleblowing is typically done when you're exposing information because what a company is doing is unethical.
Mm-hmm.
But in exposing that information, you are doing something illegal. You are pledged to keep that information to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just so much ink has been spilled. I'll throw some links in the show notes about the ethics of whistleblowing and some of the thoughts on it. But whistleblowing is one of those situations where we can agree that you have an obligation to whistleblow.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if something is happening that it, and the standards by which we set for that say a lot about what we think lets you expose people's confidences or secrets. So, I mean, when people are going to be in danger is a big one.
Yeah, I've got another example. So I'm on an ethics board, and when we review research or the ethics applications for research, a lot of times researchers with good intentions will say, you know, don't worry, your information is going to be anonymous and your information is going to be kept in strict confidence.
Mm-hmm.
And usually we have to point out that, you know, like for various reasons, no, it's not going to be anonymous. You can still proceed with a study as long as you disclose that you cannot guarantee anonymity. But more importantly for this conversation, you can't always guarantee confidence if in holding confidence, real or perceived harm can come to somebody or somebody else involved. So a person who confesses that, you know, they might seriously harm themselves or somebody else, you can break confidence in that regard in order to ensure their safety.
There are interesting ethical questions about that, about whether or not that is actually like breaking confidence when someone expresses a desire for self-harm or suicide is actually the right thing to do.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is one of those things where in the immediate sense, the answer is an obvious yes.
Mm-hmm.
Like you're like, obviously this is true. But at the same time, when you get into the thorny bits of like, does a person own their own life?
Mm-hmm.
You know, with regard to things like the right to die on your own terms. I'm looking for a word and I can't find it. but we just had some legislation come down to this in Ontario.
Like right to die or euthanasia?
Euthanasia, that's the word I was looking for. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I could not find it. But yeah, when we talk about things like euthanasia and medically assisted euthanasia and things like that, you know, and even agreements like DNRs, you know, mm-hmm. resuscitate agreements, mm-hmm. there's, like, it is clear that we believe that a person has the right to do that. Mm-hmm. And so, in a sense, in preventing them, mm-hmm. we, you know, there's, again, it's a problem in the abstract if you really like armchair thinking about it. In the practical sense, the only appropriate response to someone telling you that they're going to kill themselves is to tell them not to kill themselves. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, the world... Well, I said it in a video long, long ago. The world is poorer without you in it. Mm-hmm. But it is the subject of many armchair ethics discussions. But I mean, certainly, there, like an intent to harm others mm-hmm. is pretty uncontroversial. Mm-hmm. You know, you do not have the right to harm others. Mm-hmm. So, or to have harmed others. You know, you can't go to your doctor and confess to a string of murders mm-hmm. and expect doctor-patient privilege to cover you no matter what you saw on television.
Didn't we talk about in the pre-show too that even if we assume lawyer-client confidentiality or whatever is not absolute?
Yes.
Yeah, because you said...
Paul Bernardo.
The Paul Bernardo case, yeah. The
Paul Bernardo case, and I'm drawing on a memory from a while ago, but I'll put some supporting links in the show notes. Was broken open in part because he confessed things to his lawyer that his lawyer then had to enter into evidence, mm-hmm. and it was essential in securing his conviction. Mm-hmm. Like it's we have institutional privacy and institutional privacy rules for things like doctors and patients, for things like lawyers and clients, but like what they apply to is very specific, mm-hmm. and really depend. It's one of those things I think that most often gets clouded by like TV.
Yeah,
is our understanding of how that works.
Well, and if they're even if they're not wrong, they're always contrived.
Yeah, like they're telling a story.
Sorry, it just reminds me, completely off topic, but it reminds me of the argument that I had with a buddy of mine when we were playing Yu-Gi-Oh! As children, because he wanted to play with the 2000 life rule, because that's the way they do it in the television show, and the card game tells you to play with the 8000 life rule, and he's like, no, it's 2000 the show. I'm like, yes, because it's scripted to be interesting. If it's a 2000 life rule, you're dead on turn three. That's what jumped in my mind because the topic was so heavy. I had to lighten it
up.
Well,
I mean, much like anything else in media, it's you know, even literally this media, the reality is like deeply more nuanced.
Yeah.
I'll see if I can dig up some links, but it also really depends on where you are and mm-hmm. what the law is like where you are.
Yeah.
And I know for sure in America that can differ state to state.
And it's a problem here in Canada because so much of our media is American.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, we often...
Every time I hear an Canadian say, I plead the fifth, I understand what they mean by the flinch.
Yeah.
For the record, in Canada, it's the 13th. that's the statute that you want to cite.
Yeah.
The fifth does not do that for you. But we also, I mean, we've adopted especially... I don't want to say especially in the last 20 years, but it's definitely become more common professional language in the last 20 years for adopting non-disclosure agreements.
I'd say, actually, no, I'm going to say minimum 30 years. I think
fair.
I think whenever I say 20 years, I still assume that goes all the way back to the 80s.
Fair.
For some reason, I'm missing a decade in my math.
But yeah, to be fair, I wasn't a professional in the 80s or 90s, so I'm not sure. But like. NDAs are common now. Hmm. Like, lots of places that you work will put you under an NDA. Even just playing in, like, video game betas or RPG betas, they'll have a boilerplate NDA for you to sign.
Yep.
That says you can't tell anybody about the details of this, and if you do, there are consequences.
Yeah, or non-competes. You know, you finish with us, you're not allowed to go to a competitor. And...
yeah, well, I mean, non-competes are more common, but I don't think they relate as deeply to privacy.
No,
like, it's true. That idea that you're gonna like under an NDA, you're required to keep all kinds of things private.
Mm-hmm.
And that above and beyond, you know, like trade secrets and things like that, basic details and elements. Like, and that depends on the specifics
mm-hmm.
of the contract itself.
Yeah.
But especially with software companies, they're really common.
Yeah.
With any kind of company that handles private information.
Yep. Well, I mean, just as a not even as a kind of. Corporate or technological one, but at the college, I can talk about an example. I had a parent email me, not me specifically, but me. I one of the email accounts that I monitor, because he hadn't heard from his son in a while, and he was getting a little worried about it. And so he like gave me the name and stuff, and you know what program, and I had to say I'm sorry, I can't disclose any info. I can't even confirm if this person exists at the college.
I can't. I forget. I can't. I can go look, but I can't tell you. I can't even go look.
Yeah.
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 I can't disclose any information about students. That means,
even if you claim and are legitimately the parent, I'm like, sorry, but I have alerted security who are empowered to be able to investigate this for you, kind of deal.
Yeah. You need to go through people who are empowered to do that. Yeah.
So our clients, which in this case is the students, they have a certain privacy that I have to maintain as an agent of the college.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's a really good example.
Even from parents, like, and that's the funny thing, because you often hear anecdotally parents are more involved with student stuff, and realistically sometimes we can get in trouble if we're conversing more with the parent than with the student themselves, especially once they turn 18. You know,
yep.
It's like, well, I'm sorry, like this is information I can only disclose if you can get the person to email me with consent that I am allowed to speak to you on, like, and you're allowed to talk to me on your behalf.
What are my kids' grades?
Yeah,
I remember. From grad school, I got one of those emails. It was like, tell me what my kids' grades are.
Yeah.
Like, 100% never going to happen.
Yeah.
I don't even think I responded to the email. Yeah. I was TAing, and I went to the prof, and I was like, I got this email. And they were like, do not respond to that. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. There's no, like, and it's one of those things, it's interesting in that sense, because privacy, the act of maintaining privacy there doesn't just protect the person whose privacy you are respecting.
Mm-hmm.
It also protects you from liability.
Mm-hmm.
The thing with institutional privacy is that if you're responsible for breaking that privacy and it has consequences, you know, it has real life effects that, you know, that person isn't in fact a parent and uses that information in some way that they shouldn't have.
Mm-hmm.
Then you're responsible for that.
Mm-hmm.
And there's an armchair ethics discussion about that too, about how responsible are we for consequences of our actions that we could not have imagined.
Yeah.
And I mean, I'm gonna boil it down into. In most circumstances, we are better to err on the side of caution.
Mm-hmm.
We are, I mean, information that we hold that is private, confidences that we hold, it is almost always better to disclose them only with the consent of the person involved or mm-hmm. the people involved.
Yeah.
I mean, secrets, your secrets are your secrets. You can do whatever you want with them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what makes them great. But other people's secrets are not your secrets. They do not belong to you.
Yeah.
I mean, that was the when I divvied up the notion of secrets and confidences. That was the big thing. Is that like these do not belong to me. They are things placed in my safekeeping. Whether those are confidences that my friends tell me, or private information for work. I mean, the question is with my friends is, am I a good friend? Am I a trustworthy person? And the question with my work is, like, this is my professional reputation. What kind of reputation do I want to have? Mm-hmm. You know, do I want to be someone who can be relied on? And I think that in 70 odd episodes, I think we can agree that I at least want to be that person. So you can leave your secrets in the comments.
We promise not to share them.
I don't promise that.
Okay.
I will, in fact, if you leave enough secrets in the comments, I will build a secret. I will compile them all into a post at conceptcrucible.com so that we can all read them. I mean, I didn't get to talk about, like, the power of sharing secrets, but it is a powerful and fun thing to do. Like, the reason why I stopped keeping, anxiety and things like that a secret is because when I talk about it, I know that I am not afraid to talk about it. And it gives me courage. It gives me strength. Like, many, many of our secrets do not need to be. They are burdens that we carry unnecessarily. Mm-hmm. And it feels good to release those burdens. Mm-hmm. Release your burden in the comments. Or don't, as you wish to. But either way, I'm Jim.
I'm Ryan.
We're signing off.
Stay awesome.
Because Kyle and I last night were talking about crossing the border. Mm-hmm. Because border guards on the U.S. border have been asking people for their passports. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, never under almost any circumstances give anyone your password to anything. Mm-hmm. Like, obviously there are exceptions to that, but generally, never, ever. Like, especially if they wear a uniform.